we have taken this definition in the very first lecture that naturally we will have a system to take care of each and everything related to data, right? So when we have collected the data, it is the first task of database system. So from now I am going to use this term called database system, right? So when we say system, it means it will have this notion that there will be input, there will be output, and in between there is a kind of computing block is available which will process it, which will basically do the intended task, you can say. So the first thing we will be going to see what is the different elements of database system. Then we will have idea about schema. There is a term in the database which is called schema, though it is very related to real life situation also. We used to say schemes, right? So let's have a scheme, let's have a plan, something like that. So a scheme is nothing, a schema is nothing, but it is a first outline, first impression, you know. Yeah, you want, I'm getting some voice. So okay, yeah, so if you are having any question, just let me know, or maybe we can continue, right? Still I'm getting some noise from background.
Sir, some one mic is on by mistake.
Yeah, it's okay. So I'm let me keep in mute. Okay, so from here still I'm getting some I don't know why it is happening. Maybe Teja. Right, so schema is something related to, you can say, the things which are basically outlined or maybe planned, right? So schema of things or plan of things, something like that. But schema basically represents entire you know, conceptual idea that this is how data will be shown to you. Like in the previous class itself, we have said whenever we are having the data objects and whenever we plan to show the data to user, so the tabular way of showing the data is one of the way. So this is schema. So this you can say the schema structure for the data in the form of tabular. So it is the scheme which decide that tabular structure will be used to the show the data to the user, right? It is the schema which decides that data in the physical level will be kept in B+tree structure, right? So schema control most of the things which are related to data representation. So that's why schema came from. Now after getting this, there is a very unique and important concept in the database system design, and it is called data independence. And this is very very important concept and related to the concept of abstraction, right? And we are using term data independence, DI, right? And this is a very so most of the students assume that this is nothing, but it is abstraction. No, but there is a minute difference between DI and data abstraction that we will be going to discuss, right? And based on this, we will start opening up about the different parts of your syllabus, right? So with this, let's start, right? So in the previous lectures, we have taken this definition of database as a collection of similar data objects with similar details, right? So database is nothing. It is a, so basically it is a collection. It is a it is a combination of two aspects. First aspect is naturally data, or maybe more than one data object. Second one is the base. So base is nothing. It is a sometimes you can say the structure, the syntax, you can say, right? So database combines to a structure or a syntax, or you can say syntax for the collection of the data objects with the similar similar details. So this is typically what emphasizes, right? So so when we have these two things, syntax part, like we are saying, when we have the database, it means it is imposing its syntax to the collection of similar type of data objects, and naturally for these data objects we will be getting these similar details, right? So naturally we have to impose a syntax on the database objects, and we have to apply these, or we have to collect the similar details, right? And naturally when we have these things to achieve, there is a need of a system, right? So we need a database system. So database system is basically, it is a, like in a computer systems, or maybe in any enterprise systems, we need to have this elementary system which is called database system, right? Like in our systems, our laptops or PC, we are not having any database system. We are having a system which is called file system, right? So it is not same as the database system, file system, right? File system. And then you have to read about what is the difference between a file system or database system, right? That you have to understand. Maybe the purpose of both systems, file system and database system, is same, but it is not equivalent or it is not similar to the database system, right? But whenever you want to run a program, whenever you want to store a database in your PC or in your laptop, you have to install or you have to configure. Most of the cases in modern situations, modern time, there is a software available in your PC or laptop which is dealing with or which is related to the database system. Like in case of Unix-based operating system, they are providing these things. They are providing a by default database system into it, right? Similarly, not in the case of Windows-based system. Windows-based systems requires a separate installation of database system. So because this whole entire operating system is designed on the file system, right? So there are various systems where file system is used to maintain each and everything related to the files, right? So because we are assuming in the personal, at least in the personal systems, PCs or laptops, whatever we are keeping, it is not a data. That's what was the assumption, right? And each and everything in the form of files, or maybe even documents is called files. That's why it is preferred to have a file system, right? But in basically in different situation where we are assuming that the data is being collected, data object is being collected, then you require a database system, right? So typically, when we have a database system, then you need to have a specific software to basically achieve a particular operation, right? So you need a proper software system, and to manage the database system's functionality, you need to have a autonomous or maybe a set of procedures, set of package, which is referred as a DBMS, which is called Database Management System, right? So you can take it like this, Database Management System. So the purpose of Database Management System, which is referred as a DBMS, is to implement each and everything or each and every responsibility of database system, right? So it is basically, so DBM system is not a single software. It is a collection of SWs, right? Or maybe you can say programs also. It is like, like we have MS Office. There we have multiple MS Office. There we have multiple features like Word. Then we have Excel, something like that. See, right? So it is similar. So you cannot say that MS DBMS, any DBMS is a single software. It is a collection of software for the program. So sometimes it is called as a suite also, right? So you can use this term also. So most of the cases you must have heard about Oracle 9i. This is one of the prominent DBMS software. Then there is from IBM DB2. Right. So in the most recent version, Oracle has released a version called this 11, probably G, which is called 11G. So this G stands for grid computing. This I stand for internet. Right. So every version of Oracle will have something attached to it. Right. So there are around I can count it 128 DBMS softwares are available. Right. Probably in the entire world. But out of these 128, one or two are very popular, and most of the systems are having these DBMS software. So we will discuss about this particular thing in the labs, and in the lab of this course, you will have this whole idea that how a particular DBMS system works for programming support, for data retrieval, for data management. So because it is the DBMS which provides each and everything on the top of database system, right? So let's see how particular database system and DBMS system will work, right? So you can see carefully this diagram. So here you can see on the outside of this world, outside of this orange line, orange box, there is this entity placed users, or maybe programs also, because from a database or from a database system, it is not only the user who interacts. Sometimes it is possible that there is an interaction between a DBMS or maybe database with outside systems, right? So with this, you can assume, so this this orange line outlines the whole database system. So when I say term database, it means primarily three levels. First is the application program queries. Then there is a inner layer, which is considered as the middle layer. There we place the DBMS software. Then there is a, in the bottom, there are, you can see, two cylinders. So one is to store the actual database, one is to store the metadata, right? So you must have this name, this, you can recall this term metadata, right? So metadata is something which is related to data, which defines the data, which basically explains the data, original data, data which is kept in the right side store, right? So primarily, whenever I say database system, you should have this diagram in your mind that, okay, we are talking about three layered architecture, three layer arrangement. On the top, within the database, on the top, we have some applications. We may have some GUIs. So whatever interface we are having, like in the case of SBI, like in the case of IRCTC system, like in the case of any websites also, these websites, these GUIs, these user interfaces are placed on the first level, right? Where they are written as application programs or maybe queries also. So queries, why queries are written? Because in some cases, like in your PCs where we are having a Unix system, whenever you are going to implement something on the database, you will get a terminal, right? So terminal emphasizes the query. So query is also written here. Query is also placed in the first level. So after getting a lot of user queries, a lot of user interaction on the first level, the second level, which is actual database level. So in the data DBMS software level, this is sometimes called middle layer also, sometimes called it is conceptual or logical level also. We will get into it in the next next page actually. So in the middle layer, each and everything is placed. Like whenever you get a query, you need compilation, you need to process it. So whatever compilation, whatever runtime utilities are required, each and everything is kept in the middle level, right? Even you can say that we have created during the database storage process, we have created the access path of the data object particular. So particular object, data object is kept in which part of the data database storage system. So there is unique, there is a specific, you know, scheme available which stores that a particular data object is kept in this particular location. So that thing is called allocation schema, right? So whenever you request a data, the query will be processed and query will request this location that from where I could get the data object, right? So basically, after having this particular clarity, that after getting a query in the middle layer, we are going to resolve each and every query, and we will at last of this middle level execution, we will get to the physical data storage to get the data object. That is very simplistic, that is very obvious also. And in the bottom, we are simply having these two storage devices where we are keeping each and every data object in its actual form, right? So whatever query we have submitted, it has been verified, it has been compiled, and it has been sent to, the request has been sent to the bottom level to get the data, exact data objects, right? And then simply it goes back to the user. So this is what it is happening within the database system. So database system is one of the utility in your laptop. It is one of the utility in the servers, database servers, or maybe any application, right? So this three level architecture is the one of the traditional architecture. I am not saying that in this whole world, whatever database systems are there, they are having only these three levels, right? Like in the case of parallel database systems where we are having parallel computing or maybe cloud computing, or maybe, so for different environment, you need to add some layers, right? You need to add some layers. Like in the case of distributed database, which is one of the type of the database, you will have the data objects kept in. So these physical structures will be kept in more than one places, physical location, more than one physical locations, but you need to centralize this. So then you have to create some layers, you have to add some layers in between in the middle level. Like for the parallel computing, you need to make some other arrangement. For the cloud computing, cloud database, you need to create different levels. So based on your requirements, now naturally the computation requirement, you need to add something on a certain layer, right? Because each and every computing scenario requires some sort of synchronization, or there are various things attached to it, but primarily you can see this is the most fundamental system. And in the most of the cases where we are having centralized computing, so typically you can say this is the architecture which is most appropriate for centralized system, where we are having the physical storage and DBMS system and application queries attached to one single system, one single operating system, one single database system, right? So typically after getting into it, let's see how specific layers has been provided. So this is something more simplified view. Let me drag to the next page. Yes, so this is something more relatable, you can see. Now, so you can interpret the same three level schema by using these three specific diagram. And there we have placed some of the important aspect of the database. So you can see in the bottom, there is a user. User could be anyone like us. You can go to ATM, so you could be a user. And on the ATM, because you are trying to access your bank details, so view one, right? So you can read here, V1, V2, V3, and VN. So these are the views on the same database. So you, on the same database, you could have multiple views. So suppose we are assuming this SBI system, right? SBI banking system, and there is a specific bank branch where you have opened your account. So each and every accounts or each and every customer's detail has been kept in one single server, right? So as far as one particular user concerned, so like person ABC has this request to verify his account details. So he will go to the ATM, which is V1. And through ATM terminal, he can enter some credentials and verify the account details. And we have requested for mini statements, right? So in the same user, ABC will go to the view one, which is through terminal, and can verify his account details. That is one instance. On the next day, the same user ABC can go to the you can say net banking profile on his phone or maybe laptop, and he can verify or he can perform a transaction using net banking profile view. So this is same. This is the second view on the same database system. So you can assume that in a particular system, you can have multiple views on the same database, right? So data object is same. And you can see the data values are same, data schema is same. So each and if so, there is no change, but we are having multiple views, right? We are having multiple views on the same single instance of the database, right? So this is what is the capacity of modern day database systems. And this is something, so this is this multi-view feature is one of the first feature which have the difference between file systems. So in the file system based operating system or maybe systems, you cannot have this privilege of multiple views on the same database. But in the case of database system, you can have this privilege to have multiple views on the same database system, right? So database is same. So at the physical level, we are not having multiple views. On the conceptual level, we are not having two multiple views. So on the both levels, conceptual level, which is middle, physical level, which is the bottom, we are having same single instance of the schema, same single instance of the representation of the data. But on the top level, where user is available, where user is interacting, we could have multiple views on the same database system, right? So now you can see other terms also. You can see in the so this outer box where different views are placed, there is a term written external level. So this is simply a three level architecture, three levels. So we have defined three levels. So first level is for user, which is external level. Then we have this middle level, right? Middle level, which is conceptual level. Then we have physical level. So on any database system, conceptually, we are having three levels: external, conceptual, physical, right? And when we are saying there are three levels, within each, there will be three different views. There are three different kind of processing will be going to happen, right? So this is something which says you need to have a schema, right? So you could read here in the physical level, this term is written called internal schema. And the middle level, You can see there is term written is conceptual schema. In the top level where user is available, it is external schema, right? So we have three levels. For each level, we have different respective schema, right? For physical, we have internal. Conceptual, we have conceptual schema. For external, we have external schema. Now let's understand the term schema. So, and why it is important to have three different schemas for three different layers, right? In the first lecture, or maybe in the second lecture, we have specifically placed this term, or maybe this importance, that the data which we see in our systems, or in ATM, or in your net banking profile, or maybe IRCTC profile, the data which we see is not as the form which is stored in the physical level. That is for sure, right? So it is clearly observed, or maybe it is coming from a technical constraints, that whatever database systems or database storage layer can retain with it, it cannot be in the readable form, right? And that's why we need to have different transformations, right? So you can make sure that whatever is the form of data in the physical level is one form, and whatever is the form we are able to read is another form of the data, which might be the actual form of the data, right? So we have two types, or maybe two representation of the same data. In the user level or external level, it is one, and on the physical level, it is another, right? And there is this another way of representing the same data at the conceptual level also, because in the conceptual level, we have placed what? Compilers, processor. There are various things which are going to happen. In the conceptual level itself, we are going to verify the location of the data, right? Then you have to understand the user request, right? So you can say the query interpretation. There is other utility for that. So in the conceptual layer, we are having multiple utilities, and these utilities will be reading the data or transforming the data with respect to user concern, right? So that's why in the basic database system, where we have three levels, you need to have, or you need to provide at least three representation, three different types of the data, right? And these types are closely related to the schema need. That's why we need three schema architecture, three schema versions into the system, right? So it is very clear that in the physical level, we need to have one representation for the data objects. There is, and that's this whole representation at the physical level is called internal schema, right? So schema controls the representation part. It should be very clear to you. What is the need of schema? Schema defines the representation of the data at a certain level. That should be the proper definition for you. So whenever a question raises to you that what is schema, you can say schema is a conceptual term. It defines the representation of the data at a specific level, at a specific place, right? So when we say internal schema, it means it is talking about the schema at the physical level, or schema at the storage level, right? When I say conceptual schema, it is a schema which defines the representation of the data at conceptual level, or maybe a middle level. When I say external schema, it means it defines the representation of data at the external level for the user, right? And in the external schema, we could have multiple views, right? So whatever data representation you will get in the ATM machines, it is one external view, one external schema. Whatever we are getting in net banking, it is one other one. Whatever you will get in some other form of terminals in the SBI system, so that is coming from the external schema. So external schema allows you to have different views on the same data, right? And if we have three levels, then we need three schema. And if we have three schema and three levels, we need some mappings to relate two schemas. So you can see we have three levels. Now, whenever we are having two levels, this is external, then conceptual, then physical, right? So we have three different representation of the same data. We are having three representation, and naturally from physical to conceptual schema, if you want to move the data from physical storage to the conceptual and conceptual to user view, you need some mappings, right? You need some mapping, some bridges, right? So it is like if you want to send someone from one place to other place, you need to create a bridge, you need to create a link, something like that, right? So here is the role of conceptual conceptual to internal mapping, then external to conceptual mapping. So these arrows, you can say, are indicating these mappings. So mappings basically helps you to achieve this transformation, right? This connection between different levels, because eventually, whenever we are submitting a query to the external schema, this query will be sent to the conceptual schema through these mappings. And at the conceptual level, whatever query is compiled, whatever location has been identified to the data object, will be sent to the physical level schema, right, through conceptual slash internal mapping, right? And this data which is being extracted or identified will be sent back to or sent back to conceptual schema through this mapping, and again it is forwarded to the end user, right? So this data transmission will happen in a certain layer, and this mapping will be used to send the data back to the user, right? So this is the need of external mapping, right? Though mappings between two levels has some implication, it has some importance, right? Because through these mappings only we create separation between layers. So when I say separation between levels, separation between schema, it means it is a sort of abstraction, right? So when I say through this mapping, we can easily achieve this separation and this a boundary, a wall between two different schemas. So schema between schema external and conceptual, there is this mapping called external slash conceptual mapping. This separates two levels. This separates two schema, right? And this separates the detailings. So by having this simple mapping, you can claim that at a conceptual level, we are not able to see the details of, we are not able to see the implementation detail at the external schema, right? And you can similarly, you can say at the physical level, because of this conceptual and external mapping, you can say, I'm not able to see the conceptual level details. And you can say, it is nothing to do with me, my task at physical level, what is happening in the conceptual level, right? So with this, you can have a specific separation between two schemas, right? By using this mapping. And that's the concept called independence also. So because we have kept the data in the different representation in different levels here, and through this conceptual internal mapping, we are able to achieve this separation, right? So you can say we are having different three different versions of the same data in the database system because of this mapping, right? This mapping provides us the separation, right? So now let's read some theoretical aspects also. So these theoretical details are written for your convenience. And we have partially understood that what is schema, right? The data, the way the data at certain level is represented as referred as a schema. A schema simply controls the whole representation of data at a certain place or level, right? That's the theoretical aspect or theoretical details about it, right? And then if you read it, so this typical structure, this typical view of the database system, so this is what a typical database system is with respect to elements or terms or maybe components. This is something very useful or maybe very conceptual, and this provides three schema view of the database system and its mapping. So this particular diagram is referred as a three schema view of the database system, right? And this is one of the first concept of the database system. So whenever you goes for an exam or for any interview, this is something related to the very first question, possibly even the second question, right? So usually ask, what is the three schema architecture? What is the three schema? So within this three schema structure, why we are using mappings? What is the purpose of having three schema, not four schema, right? You can have four or five schemas. So why we are not having four schema architecture? So you need to answer all these things, right? And we will be having a discussion upon it. So why to have four layers, why to have five layers, right? So when we will discuss the different types of database, then you can correlate that why we are having three schema, four schema or five schema architecture. In the case of cloud-based system, you could have five labels, right? So then we have physical, conceptual, and then in the view label, in the view level, we will be adding more labels. That's what, right? Like in the case of file system, there are only 0-2 labels, right? In the case of file system, this external schema and conceptual schema is combined. That is for sure, right? And this is something related to that. Whenever you want to understand the difference between file system and database system, you can clearly see that in the case of file system, there are only 2 labels, 2 schemas. In case of database, there are at least three labels. There are at least three schema, right? In the case of file system, you will not have this privilege to have multiple views on this top level. But in the case of database system, you can design as much as number of possible of views on the external schema, right? And this is because we have separated external schema from the conceptual schema. So when you separate 2 labels, it is easy to modify one, right? It is easy to modify one. And this is one of the capacity of concept called data independence. So we have created separate schemas, and in between schemas, we have provided mappings. So through this mapping, because each and everything is separated, you do not need to bother about the other schema. So you can, whatever is the plan, whatever is the task you want to perform at certain level, like in the physical level, you can add as much as possible database systems, as much as data storage components. In the conceptual level, you can modify the compiler, you can modify the query processor, whatever task you can do, you can do. You do not need to bother about other levels, right? Because the different schemas are kept in different separated layers, right? So this is something is coming from the positives of database systems. This is not easily available or achievable in the case of your file system, right? So with this, if you read, a few theoretical details are given to you to read it about. And there is this called concept data independence and its role. So data independence is nothing, it is a concept. So let's briefly read it. So concept of data independence and its role. So precisely we have taken it as a theoretical part. So now read. So the concept of data independence is designed and implemented to provide the separation. You can read it. The separation between two levels of details. Two levels means two schema primarily. It is nothing more than that. So let me highlight it. All right. So two levels of details, two labels or two schemas of details. Then BI simply separates, data independence simply separates the representation of data, right? So it simply separates the representation of data in two layers of three-layer schema. So this is with respect to the figure which we have just discussed, that when we say DI is existing or DI is available, it simply separates the two schemas. So when we say two separate schema, it means the representation is separated, right? This is then figure 2 shows the three schema representation of a database system. Here you can see the three different labels: external for user view, middle or conceptual slash logical for machine component view, and the external is for hard drive, server, or this thing, right? So I hope these things are basically clear to you. Right, so we have an external view, then we have a middle view, then we have this thing. Now, concept of DI will implement a kind of separation. So this is very obvious. We did complete the kind of separation among two schemas, and there are two instances of it. Right, first is external to conceptual, then we have conceptual to internal. Right, so because we have 3 layers, 1, 2, 3. So between 3 layers, there are 2 mappings, 2 separations, right? And due to which you can perform any changes at any levels without affecting other schemas. So this is also we have properly conveyed. So because we have separated these 3 levels, so you can perform whatever you want to perform without affecting others. Other layer will not get any idea. It will not be affected at all. That's what the capacity or capability of DI is a concept, right? So this is a very specific example of it. Like we all have accounts on SBI banking systems. During the day or night, we perform any operation over accounts detail SBI database server kept in the internal schema, Right now, SBI technical team usually performs some additions at their service schema, or maybe perform some correction or correlation among two database tables and component labels. In both cases, we hardly get to know and difficult to spot the change. So actually, it is not the case that this database system or maybe this SBI system is not going to maintain. They are maintaining the database systems, and this is with respect to, or this is which we collision with our operations also, right? So they are doing so, but we are not able to trace these changes, right? Maybe in your profile you will get some idea that okay, this new feature has been added, but this you know, whatever task they are doing at the conceptual or maybe the server level, it is hard to get any idea about these operations, right? This is because of DI thing, because each and everything is separated. So this is it about today's discussion. If you have anything to ask, just let me know, right?